Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Robert. I don't know if you know that song, but it's dedicated to all of you. We love you just the way you are. The song is I Love You Just the Way You Are. Beautiful. Thank you. Well, it's good to be here again in front of all of you. It's my second time back in over a year, so I'm grateful that I'm able to do this. My mom and I watch this from home every Sunday. After I do the Bible class, I run up to her room and I turn on the laptop and I get her ready and we sit there and watch the service together. So today, Mom and my daughter are watching the service, and I hope that I do them both proud today. She loves watching the temple service, and she sits there and she amens. You know, she's Baptist, so you can, you know, she talks back to the TV. She gets really into the lesson, and she'll say, that was a good lesson. And she even quotes scripture. So if there's a scripture being said, she says, I can't remember the book or the chapter verse, but I know the scripture, and she can roll it off her tongue. She's better than I am. So welcome to Unity Temple on the Plaza, where diversity is praised and peace and harmony are the rewards. I'm Reverend Sandra Campbell, and it's my honor to join you here today. I just have one brief announcement, and that is that we have a special guest today. You probably don't recognize this person. Who is that man? And somebody, is that her husband? No, he's not. This is Mr. Sharif Abdullah. And many of you know that a few months ago we did a program, over a year ago, in Courageous Conversations, where we introduced Sharif Abdullah's book, The Chronicles of the Upheavals. We started with his book, Creating a World That Works for All. And so we had buttons available in the bookstore, and you could buy a Creating a World That Works for All button. He wrote a book by that title, and his newest book is The Chronicles of the Awakening. Now, I don't know about you, but just the title itself makes me very interested, and I've had the opportunity to read some of the book. They're available in the lobby after the service, and he'll be signing them for you. And then this afternoon from 12:30 to 2, he will be our special guest for Courageous Conversations, which started on his book about inclusivity, creating a world that works for all. So I hope you'll join us. Those at home can join us on Zoom this afternoon. If you don't know how, you go to unitytemple.com. Click on events, click on Courageous Conversations, and join us. There are lots of things going on at Unity Temple. I won't bore you with everything because you're not going to want to hear from me. You're going to want to hear what this man has to say. I want to tell you that he has he's a lawyer. He doesn't practice law anymore. He travels the world teaching people how to be more inclusive, which we could use in our society today, couldn't we? And one of the things that impresses me the most is he's a futurist. So if you've ever read, in the 1970s, when I was in college taking psychology, one of the first books I read was Alvin Toffler's Future Shock. How many of you read Future Shock? Well, this is a modern day Alvin Toffler. So he's going to talk to us about where we're headed and how you and I can play a role in creating the beloved community that's been prophesied by so many people, including Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., that we're already in that process of creating this beautiful new environment, this new city, this new Jerusalem, this new heaven, and this new earth. So I invite you, we can join now in giving, just warming up and welcoming our guest speaker, Sharif Abdullah. More information about happenings at Unity Temple are available on the website, or you can call the church office during the week. We now begin our spiritual celebration with the temple chimes, the peace prayer, and the call to inspiration with Geneva Price. Let us join together in the peace prayer. On this day, we dedicate ourselves to peace on earth. We accept ourselves without harsh judgment to experience a sense of unity with all people. We meet the events of this day with confidence. We accept others without prejudice to experience a sense of unity with all people. We honor our earthly environment and recognize a oneness with all creation in harmony with ourselves, our lives, other people, and all of nature. We live this day with a peaceful mind, a peaceful heart, and a peaceful spirit. Thank you, God. Amen.
We've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in His holy word. He's never failed us yet. Oh, don't turn around. We've come this far by faith. So
another round of applause to Peggy and her son, Asa. Thank you. That was beautiful. And he's also a student of Jim Mayer's, so Jim, where's Jim? You taught him well. Thank you. Today we're going to talk about faith, and I'm going to introduce it with the daily word, and then I'm going to turn it over to Sharif to talk about what kind of faith we need, what kind of faith we have to get us beyond what we've been going through to a greater reality, to birth this new world. So today's daily word is faith. My faith keeps me focused on God. That's the affirmation. My faith keeps me focused on God. I may not be able to control what happens around me, but I am always free to choose what happens within me. My perception determines my experience. I begin with faith. I choose to see the vibrant wholeness that is present even during illness. I may open my heart and mind to the harmony that I know is possible even in the midst of apparent discord. When my needs appear greater than my resources, I remind myself all supply springs forth from the inexhaustible well of divine substance. I am reassured by remembering all situations are temporary and God is greater than every circumstance. Through my faith, I align my thoughts with the divine and believe in this truth that sets me free. The scripture with today's daily word is one of my favorites. It's from the book of Luke, the 17th chapter, the 6th verse. If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you, and nothing will be impossible to you. What you're about to hear are possibilities of us creating a world that works for all. Sharif Abdullah said in his book, our vision of a world that works for all is a world of peace, one without violence, one that is inclusive, where all of our differences are stepping stones and not obstacles, a world of abundant enoughness for all, where no one suffers from too little or too much. Sharif?
Thank you. Good morning. That was almost all of you. Let's try again. Good morning. Okay, that was just about it. Yay. So I want to talk to you for a bit about the concept of faith. And I wanted to say, give you a quote from a book that I did not bring with me, Seven Seeds for a New Society. And the quote is from Henry David Thoreau. He said, though I do not believe that a plant will spring up where no seed has been, I have great faith in a seed. Convince me that you have a seed there, and I am prepared to expect wonders. All of our wonders begin with a seed. Everything we do, everything that we accomplish in our world begins with the seed. And sometimes that seed is you. And sometimes in order for us to achieve something, we need you to be the seed. We know the problems that we have in our society. In my book, Creating a World That Works for All, the introduction was supplied by President Václav Havel when he was president of the Czech Republic. And people ask me, why did I have President Havel provide the introduction? And I tell them I'd like to help struggling writers. So President Havel said, humankind today is well aware of the spectrum of threats looming over its head. We know that the number of people living on our planet is growing at a soaring rate. We know that the already deep abyss separating the planets poor and rich could deepen further. We also know that we've been destroying the environment on which our existence depends, and that we're headed for disaster by producing weapons of mass destruction and allowing them to proliferate. And yet, even though we're aware of these dangers, we do almost nothing to avert them. So this is a very flowery and literate way of saying that we're all stuck on stupid. We know what we have to do, we know the challenges that are facing us, and we do something else. That is intolerable. We cannot tolerate that. We have to do something different, and we have to be the we that does that different thing. We can't wait around for leaders who constantly fail us. We can't wait around for this side to keep bickering with that side while the car keeps going at 100 miles an hour to the cliff. The things that we have to do are pretty simple. And because they're so simple, we say, oh, we'll do that next year. We'll get around to feeding those people next year. We'll get around to providing health care for those folks next year. And then after a while, you can't do it anymore. So in my book, The Power of One, Authentic Leadership in Turbulent Times, I talk about the recipe for frog soup. Get a frog, drop them in lukewarm water, and they sit there. And you slowly crank the water up. And by the time the water gets to boiling, the frog is so damaged it can't jump out. So we're in the water. It's getting to the point of maybe this is uncomfortable. And what we need to be doing, instead of jumping out, we need to figure out how to turn off the heat. We need to figure out how to do things differently. How hard is it to do things differently? How hard is it for us to do the different thing and have faith that things are going to turn out the right way? Something you may not know is that it takes a very long time for when you plant a fruit tree and the time you actually get fruit from it. This is a quote in Creating a World That Works for All, by a Brazilian theologian by the name of Rubem Alves. He says, "Let us learn from those who plant dates. A date tree takes 80 years, that's 80 years, from the time it is planted to bear its first fruit. To plant a date tree is an act of faith, a sign of hope, and a symbol of one's loving commitment to the future. Let us plant dates, even though we who plant them will never eat them. We must live by the love of what we will never see. This is the secret discipline. It is the refusal to let our creative act be dissolved away in immediate sense experience, and is a stubborn commitment to the future of our grandchildren. Such disciplined love is what has given prophets, revolutionaries, and saints the courage to die for the future they envisioned. They make their own bodies the seed of their highest hopes. They make their own bodies the seed of their highest hopes." I think about that once in a while when I'm traveling around the world and traveling in some very dicey situations. It's not just that I'm, a lot of you have traveled in the world, but when you travel, do you travel in the same culture around the world? Or do you leave your culture, do you leave your circumstances and experience the world the way the people of the world are experiencing it? I've been in situations where I'm eating with poor rice farmers, and you're eating in their little hut, and you know, because I'm the guest of honor, they're preparing the best food that they have, and maybe even the only food they have. And you can be incredibly thankful, incredibly grateful for them to share with you from themselves. How many of us, when we travel, go from one bubble to another bubble to another bubble of our own experience? I was in Uganda and saw that the Sheraton Hotel sits, it's 25 stories high, and it sits on a 200-acre campus, and it's got a wall around it, a 20-foot wall. And when you come in from the airport in their air-conditioned vehicle, you go directly under the wall into the Sheraton. And in the 200-acre campus, they actually have an African village. And you can walk down the pathways, and you walk up to this village where all the natives are smiling and happy. And you can actually walk into their huts, and their baskets you can buy, and artwork you can put on your walls. Every one of those people is an employee of the Sheraton. And you can do your selfies with them and have the impression that you've been to Africa and you've never been there. So the question is, what kind of a seed are you when you never get planted? What kind of a seed are you when you never get watered? What kind of a seed are you when you never crack open and start growing? Will you sit there and say, I'm a seed? It's like, yeah, you know, now you're 50, 60, 70 years old, and you're still just a seed. When is the time to get cracked open? I would suggest to you that the time is right now. I was doing a talk some years ago about how our world is changing and how you need to get involved. And one of the women that was in the room said, I'm going to get involved with this. I'm buying copies of your books for my children and for my grandchildren, the great-grandchildren are too young to read it right now. And I'm going to join your organization. And the reason I'm going to join the organization is this woman was 94 years old at the time. She said, the reason I'm going to join your organization is so my grandchildren can say, my grandmom helped to found that organization. She helped to create that organization. She said, you know, all this computer stuff and computer databases and stuff like that, I can't do that. I'll get one of my grandkids to help me with it. But she says, I will never see the society that you're trying to create, but I can be a part of the start of it right now. I'm thinking of another person who said, I want to help to create a world that works for all living beings. And the way I'm going to do that is by helping you to do that. I'm going to write you a check that's going to cover your travel costs, etc., so that you can get out there and you can do this better. Each one of us can do something. You may not face down a person carrying a submachine gun pointed at you, speaking to you, yelling at you in a language that you don't understand, giving you an order that you can't understand. You don't know whether you're complying or not. If if you have done that, you know that's pretty much a life-changing experience. You do see your whole life flashing in front of you. You may not be the one that does that. You may not be the one that goes out on the street to help feed homeless people, but you can provide the support for that to happen, and therefore know that you're doing your part for feeding, nurturing, protecting, doing the things that you've been called forth to do in the Bible, in the Quran, in the Bhagavad Gita, in the Dhammapada, in every one of our holy books. It all says the same thing. We have to start treating ourselves as though we are one. If you do that, you're living the life of a true human being on this planet. Now, I've read the Bible, I've read the Quran, I've read the Bhagavad Gita, I've read the Dhammapada. Nowhere in there does it say living a full life means watching television. If there is one like that, if I missed the reference, please, after the service, let me know and I'll be glad to correct my statement. Nowhere in there, in none of those books does it say your life purpose is to play golf. Nowhere in there does it say your life purpose is to be comfortable. Everywhere it says that your life purpose is to become a true human being, true to yourself, true to your values, true to your community, and your community includes those people that you don't like. Once you see that, you get to start the process that is very hard, sometimes painful, almost always uphill. You get to take a breather every once in a while, but yeah, you're almost always going uphill, and you're being rewarded by the struggle itself. I was at a nature retreat, and I was watching someone moving some rocks, and the look on her face, the intent look on her face, I walked up to her and I said, "You are really having a ball, aren't you?" And she says with that same look on her face, "This is a labor of love." From the outside, it looks like, oh, she's really she's going to have a backache tonight. She's really moving these rocks. It isn't fun. The sun's shining. It's really hot. And she recognizes that she is in a state of ecstasy, of spiritual love. And she's getting that by moving rocks. Our challenge is for us to know our purpose, to know the purpose that the Creator put us on the planet for, and to know that what we're doing may not bear fruit in our lifetimes. To know that what we're doing may not have an immediate purpose to it. Our job is to know that our pathway leads to other human beings, to other living beings, away from all that is unliving, and that includes TV, corporations, almost all the work that you do, and leads towards something that helps you to grow in ways that are surprising even to you. Every once in a while, I lift my head up and I look and see another 10 years have gone by and I'm still not, I'm still struggling with what we're doing, and the struggle itself is my journey, not the completion of the struggle. We have to take that long view. We have to take the date tree view. And I'm going to wrap up by finding another quote. One of the problems I have is almost every page is marked. I actually like my own book. And I found it. In order for you to be who you are, you have to become a spiritual activist. You have to be spiritual, and unfortunately for most of us in this country, we think that spiritual means reading a book. We think spiritual is walking into a particular building. Where I'm suggesting to you that being spiritual means walking into every building you walk into withholding a certain energy. Doing whatever the job is, from moving rocks to making investments to whatever, but doing that from the point of view of not what's good for me, but what's good for all of humanity and the earth herself. Once we do that, we start seeing ourselves a different way. Being a mender, being an activist for an inclusive society, is a spiritual discipline. We practice a different kind of spirituality, the spirituality of turbulent times. Success doesn't mean I've saved an endangered species, or cleaned up a toxic waste dump, or fed hungry children. Success means awakening in myself a spirit that can help make a better life for others. Success means I have acted in the world as though I were a part of it, not apart from it. Success means becoming conscious of and faithful to my values and to my soul. Faithful to your values, faithful to your soul, faithful to the kind of person that you know that you are inside. I was talking to a person who, at the time, he was the head of a bank that you would know the name of, so I won't call it. And I just finished talking to him about issues of faith and issues about his own activism. When I came off the podium, he said to me, you know, when I first got out of law school, I was practicing with legal services, helping poor people, and that felt so good. I said, yeah, why don't you go back and do it? I said, what you're doing now, you don't need the money. He's looking at me like I'm shocked. Like he's like I've got, you know, horns growing out of my head or something. I said, you know, you don't need the money. Go to the point where you were feeling good about who you are as a human being, and don't worry about the money. Our challenge is, can we do what we know needs to be done? Can we feel the divine moving inside of us? can we do that and recognize that we are tied into our future, either as the balloon rising in the sky or as the baggage holding it down. And it's time for us to cut loose the baggage. Reverend Sandra and I are going to be talking about this this afternoon in the Courageous Conversations. So we'll be able to get into this a little bit more and a little bit deeper. And I invite all of you to attend, and the ones who can't attend live can come via Zoom. It'll be on Zoom. But whether you come or not, whether you attend or not, whether you ever do any of this, whether you buy the books or not, I want you to think about this. What is yours to do? How are you going to do it? And when are you actually going to get started? So I look forward to connecting with you further. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharif. Thank you. We'll now begin our time of going inside of ourselves, looking into our faith centers, asking ourselves, what is ours to do as we begin our time of meditation? For just a while, to let go of any distractions, to commit yourself to this quiet moment, to be in the presence of Spirit. I invite you to relax your body from the top of your head to the tips of your toes. And as you relax and breathe into the silence, open your mind and your heart for this brief time of focused prayer. We reset our mind and heart in the essential truth of our spiritual nature. We anchor our attention in God, the source of all that is life-sustaining. We command our mind to be attentive, our nervous system to be still, our heart to be open, our spirit to be free. By this unifying power of divine love within us, we pray in oneness with God in the silence. invite you now to come back to this room, come back to this place in time and space, feeling renewed and refreshed, and knowing that you can return to this place of stillness whenever you're ready. Take these words as your own. When I become still, I find my faith is steady. Standing on the foundation of my faith, I know exactly what to do and when to do it. Like a divine anchor within me, my faith holds firm. My mind is clear, my heart is open. I move forward from this place and this time with great courage, confidence, and poise. And now take another deep breath. And if your eyes were closed, as you feel led, you may open your eyes and return your attention to this time and this place, renewed and restored in faith. And we say, thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
Only believe. Only believe. All things are possible if you only believe. Only believe. Only believe. All things are possible. Only I know deep in my mind the love of me I've left behind, 'cause
thank you, Peggy, Asa, Jim, and Robert. And thanks to Geneva, our music team. They're fabulous, aren't they? Every Sunday they bring it. Thank you. Thank you. We usually start off with whatever the theme is going to be, whatever the word is going to be we're going to talk about, and the music team just, they just bring the message. So I really appreciate that. Music is the message. Well, it's now time for us to begin the closing of our service. I would invite you, if you have an offering, we no longer take the baskets, bring the baskets around because of safety and health, but on your way out, if you feel led to give a gift, please do so. There will be baskets outside the lobby here. And we definitely appreciate your giving, all of you at home, all of you here. We're here because of you. We're here for you. So thank you for your love, your time, your gifts. I also want to, before we close, say another word about Sharif that I forgot to mention before. Not only he mentioned he travels the world doing this, it's a labor of love for him as well. But I also want to mention that he just came back from a week-long retreat at the Light Center. And Robin Goff, who's the founder and operator of the Light Center, is here, brought him today a week long, and last Sunday he was at Unity Southeast, so we're kind of bringing up the rear, and I believe you're leaving to go where?
Back home.
Back home, to Portland, Oregon, back home. And so then I think you're going to do some more book tours, so I look forward to hearing more. Also, two of our Unity Temple's own are at the book table, and Martin and Kelly Dowman have been here for years. We taught Sunday school together probably 100 years ago. I know you're not that old. Here at Unity Temple, and they are with the Light Center also, which is in Baldwin City, Kansas. If you want to have a retreat, that's a really nice place to go. It's kind of rustic. There's cabins, and it's just a wonderful spiritual retreat, the Light Center. Look it up in Baldwin City, Kansas. And Robin Goff is here, so she can tell you all about it. So can Martin and Kelly. So we will close it with the prayer for protection. Would you please stand and join me with the prayer for protection? The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. And now the peace song. This